right, let's open up in our Bibles to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 29. Deuteronomy 29, as we continue our study, as slow and as leisurely as it may be, through the book of Deuteronomy. I'm starting to get find myself getting nostalgic. We've been studying the five books of Moses, what we call the Pentateuch or the Torah, now for, it's been over 5 years now. And we're almost done with the fifth book here. And it's been an amazing journey. And literally, the entire five books of Moses is really about the journey of the people of God ultimately into the promised land. And then, you know, by the time the book of Joshua comes and they enter the promised land, then it's about their life within the promised land, coming and going and all these different things. So this has been a rather long journey. But what's beautiful now is in chapter 29, really the book of Deuteronomy is coming to a close. And today, I've called this message a time to renew. Because what's going on now is the children of Israel are going to be asked by the Lord to renew their vows, to renew their commitment to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to the covenant that God made. And in a lot of ways, every single day for you and I, we have to re-up on our commitment to say, I want to be a follower of Jesus. Because you realize that yesterday's amazing moment with and walking with Jesus and testimony does not necessarily mean that today will be a great moment. You know, every single day has its own sets of issues and challenges, own sets of temptations. And each one of us needs to kind of re-up in the reality of who we are in Christ. Now, I'm not saying that we could lose our salvation if we have a bad moment. I mean, if that was the case, none of us would have our salvation. You know, nobody can snatch us out of his hands. But that desire to say, God, I want to honor you. I want my life to be for you is so important. And for the children of Israel, it's time for them to recommit, to renew their part of this covenant that's been made. So let's just jump right on in Deuteronomy 29, verse 1, it says this. These are the words of the covenant which the Lord commanded Moses to make with the children of Israel in the land of Moab, besides the covenant which he made with them at Horeb. Now Moses called all Israel and said to them, you have seen all that the Lord did before your eyes in the land of Egypt to Pharaoh and to all his servants and to all his land, the great trials which your eyes have seen, the signs and those great wonders. Yet the Lord has not given you a heart to perceive and eyes to see and ears to hear to this very day. And I have led you 40 years in the wilderness. Your clothes have not worn out on you. Your sandals have not worn out on your feet. You have not eaten bread, nor have you drunk wine or similar drink, that you may know that I am the Lord your God. And when you came to this place, Sihon, king of Heshbon, and Og, king of Bashan, came out against us in battle, and we conquered them. We took their land and gave it as an inheritance to the Reubenites, the Gadites, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. Therefore, keep the words of this covenant and do them that you may prosper in all that you do. Now, the idea here is they are now renewing the covenant that they made at Horeb. Now, you have to realize this all begins first that Moses goes back and he reminds them of their history. And if you read your Bible, you will find perpetually from Genesis to Revelation, there's a constant rehearsal of the Exodus narrative. It comes up over and over again. I am the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, and this is what I did. Why? Because the story of the children of Israel happened in real time, in real circumstances, and God is always looking to remind them, I am the one who did this, who delivered you from the bondage of Egypt. And in a lot of ways, it speaks of the power of the testimony. Each one of us, we have a history. Each one of us has a story. God has led each one of us on a journey, and maybe yours isn't, I am the God who delivered you out of the enslavement in Egypt, but I am the God who brought you out of your sadness or brought you out of your brokenness, or I'm the one who brought you out of feeling like nobody cares about you, and you know that I care about you because I did this in your life, and I did this in your life. See, each one of us has a story. Every single human being has a story, but for those of us who are followers of Jesus, we begin to see our history as his story. We begin to see our lives. We see the fingerprints of God in our story. And that changes the complexion of that story. See, you could imagine for the children of Israel, had it not been for the Lord, that they could spend their entire lives being like, you know, for a long time I was a slave in Egypt. And everything about their life is that they were a slave in Egypt. I was a slave in Egypt. I didn't have a normal childhood. It was horrible. Listen, their enslavement in Egypt was horrible, but it became the place of God's deliverance. And if you're here today and you're in Christ, what you find is that God has this amazing ability to be the deliverer of us in the midst of hard situations. I know for my story, where I had come out of not growing up in a godly environment in a Christian home, God can always say, I am the God who brought you out of addiction. I am the God who brought you out of feeling that nobody cared about you. You had a million friends, but nobody knew you and nobody cared. And I'm the God who brought you out of a life of drugs and all this stuff. And he's like, and I brought you this way. And I'm like, he is the God who did that to me. And that's my story. And you have your story. And the children of Israel have their story. And Moses once again says, this is what God has done. Why? Because God's working in your past will give you a clue to some of what God wants to do in your future. See, if God delivered you by a mighty hand historically, then you can trust that God can deal with what's in front of you. I think what happens is we have no problem celebrating God's deliverance in the past, but we do struggle to read it forward that my God can deliver me in this next struggle that I have. And I bet there's many of us here right now, God has done amazing things in your history, but right now you are choosing to fear. You're choosing to not trust. I've been thinking about this. I was talking with a friend of mine about the idea of stress. I heard someone say that stress is what the word sophisticated people use for fear. Because we're too cool to say that we're fearful, so I'm stressed. Right? But when you think, it's pretty powerful if you think about it that way, right? Everyone's like, oh man. But perfect love casts out fear, doesn't it? See, so what God wants to do is because of the children of Israel's history, they should be able to look at the things in front of them and say, my God was able to deliver me with a mighty hand from Egypt. He's got what's in front of me. And it causes you to think differently about your future. But what happens is although we may have experienced God's deliverance in the past, we have a tendency to be concerned about the future. But when you see what God has already done in your life, your future is pretty rock solid, isn't it? That the God who delivered you from the biggest trials and struggles of your life will lead you into tomorrow. And that's why you're going to see this all through the scriptures, this rehearsal of what God has done. Look what it says in verse 2. You have seen all that the Lord did before your eyes in the land of Egypt to Pharaoh and to all of his servants and to all of his land, the great trials which your eyes have seen, the signs and those great wonders. Yet the Lord has not given you a heart to perceive and eyes to see and ears to hear to this very day. Now what's going on here is this. Remember that because of the rebellion of the children of Israel, when they refused to go into the promised land 40 years before, the generation who was older than the age of 20 perished in the wilderness. So the group of people that Moses is talking to now, they were people who were either younger than 20 when all this went on. So maybe they're in their 50s and 60s, but they were younger when the deliverance of Egypt happened, from Egypt, or they weren't even there. And he's saying, look, you guys, some of you saw this stuff, but you didn't quite understand what was going on. And I think that's a powerful reality, isn't it? That sometimes God works, and it takes us some time to understand exactly what it means. Like, you have this experience, and that experience is like a seed that gets planted in your heart. But that seed does not germinate and blossom to fruitfulness for a while. And you ever, when you read something like that, have you ever just been like, Lord, remember that thing? Will you let that thing blossom in my heart? And what it is God's wisdom comes in time. It comes with time and reflection and prayer. And I think for a lot of us, it's one of the struggles we have in the world that we live in today, because everything's so busy and hectic that we don't actually have the time to stop and allow certain events to really marinate, to be able to pull all the wisdom that God has for us out of these events. So in some ways, what I want to encourage you to do is, I mean, think about the children of Israel. I mean, no doubt they thought about these things for years. But he's like, your eyes didn't really get it. You didn't really hear it. Your eyes didn't really perceive it. And I found myself just being like, Lord, I want to learn all that you have for me from the experiences of my life. Like, I don't want to leave any field unmined. I don't want to allow anything to pass that doesn't have spiritual nourishment for me. So it caused me to stop this week when I grabbed that verse, and I'm like, I'm going to pray about some things. And I start thinking about, you know, there's those areas, and for me, I was praying about unresolved areas. You know, whether it's a relationship that got strained or something that went on that when you think back to a situation, you're like, yeah, that didn't sit right. Why didn't it sit right? Lord, what are you doing? And I just want to encourage you to make some space in your life for that. Because even though the children of Israel, they were in the wilderness for 40 years, he's like, yeah, you guys didn't really quite get it. You don't get what really went on yet. It hasn't come together for you. But notice, from there he goes on, look what it says in verse 5, and it's really quite beautiful, because it talks about God's providence and his provision. It says, I have led you 40 years in the wilderness, right? And your clothes have not worn out. Your sandals have not worn out on your feet. You have not eaten bread, nor have you drunk wine or similar drink, that you may know that I am the Lord your God. I mean, ever think about that? How many of you are wearing the same exact shoes that you were in 40 years ago? Same clothes. Some of you are like, I wish I had the clothes I had 40 years ago. They're all back in style. You know, I could sell them on eBay and make a killing, you know. But the idea, he was like, look, you were in the wilderness. I led you, and everything that you needed, it all worked. Your sandals never wore out, right? Your clothes never fell apart. Not only that, you didn't have bread or wine. Why? Because he's like, I'm raining manna down from heaven 6 days a week. I'm miraculously feeding you. I mean, what a powerful testimony. But you know what's amazing when I think about this? The only time we realize how powerful God's provision is when we are in poverty. You only learn how faithful God is when you have no resources. And it's a bummer, isn't it? Like, I think about that. I'm like, man, I always say we never grow the most on the sunny days, but I kind of wish we did. Because I prefer the sunny days. But it's like the children of Israel learned God's amazing provision when they had no way to provide for themselves. And God's like raining manna down from heaven. And that should sustain them. I mean, like everything they needed was provided. They were thirsty, and they would bring water out of a rock. I mean, we studied this stuff together. We talked about how powerful that is. And I think for some of you right now, you're in that situation where making ends meet is not easy right now. But this is the season where God wants to show you his miraculous provision. I think about Lynn and me. We talk about our story. Man, I'll never forget when we got married. Oh, man. We fell in love. And I remember at the time I was planting a church in New Jersey. I'd been there for just about 18, 19 months. So it was a church of about 30 people, and I was working at a restaurant as a waiter to make ends meet, you know? And I remember, you know, like I'm getting married, and I'm like, man, like my earning prospects are pretty lousy right about now, you know? I started thinking, like, if this is my daughter, like I'm like, so how are you gonna provide for my daughter? Well, yeah, I do the lunch shift at this Mexican restaurant. I bring home some extra food, you know? I get a discount on bulk food, and you know, I pastor this church, 30 people in it. It's a great church. It's going to be an amazing church. But yeah, there's none of us, and there ain't no money in that either, you know. And it's like, but it works, you know. And I'll never forget, We got married, and I remember the first time, you know, like, Lynn went grocery shopping, I almost lost my hair. Because, you know, she came, you know, it's like, I'm a guy, so it's like, I'm living on, like, a can of tuna fish, and when bags of rice, like, 5-pound bags of rice were on sale, I'd buy 10 of them, you know? And every once in a while, I'd buy, like, when tuna fish was on sale, I'd buy, like, a case of that stuff, you know? And so, and Lynn was like, man, I can't live like this. And so she went grocery shopping. I'm like, how much did you spend? And she's like, oh, I spent $120. I'm like, that's like 2 months grocery money. And I'm in my budget. And she got scarred because I got, was like really like, I'm like, you got to go bring all that stuff back. You know? Like, I can't afford this. That poor girl, you know? She didn't know what she was getting into with me. But I, and I'll be honest with you, though. God's provision in those years was some of the most miraculous. Like, I remember one time I had one of my close buddies, his wife was pregnant, and they found out that the umbilical cord was wrapped around the baby's leg, right? And so they wanted to do surgery, but the insurance company wouldn't cover it because it's cosmetic. It's not life-threatening. So imagine this. So my friend's just like, man, I don't know, we're going to do a fundraiser. How much money do you need? He's like, man, well, we need about $6,000 to get this surgery done. And so, like me and Lynn talked about, we're like, well, all right, we got an extra $600 in the bank. Like, if we had a baby and that, what would we want? Like Jesus said, right? Like, do unto others, you have them do unto you. So we're like, we took that, we like wrote all the money in the bank. We're just like, here you go, right? And the next day, I got this crazy bill, you know, like you just gave all your money away and you get this horrible bill where you're like, oh. So what do? I mean, we're just young families, you know, she's going to therapy because of the grocery bill, and we just gave away all of our money, you know, and all of a sudden this crazy bill comes, and I'll never forget, I remember reading in the Bible, in the book of Isaiah, that king who received that nasty letter from that general and just laid it before the Lord. He said, Lord, I don't know what to do with this, so you got to take care of this. And so we took that big nasty bill, and we said, Lord, we gave away all of our money. Like, what are we doing, Lord? We can't handle this bill. Can you handle that bill? And I'll never forget because it must have been 4 days later, 5 days later, right? All of a sudden, Lynn's like, I'm gonna get the mail. And she's out there, and all of a sudden, I hear her gulp and kind of start to weep. And I'm like, are you okay, sweetie? She's like, oh, Daniel, you have to see this. And we walked over there. She's standing in the doorway with tears streaming down her eyes, and she has a card open, and it's from this older sister who we had known when we were in California. Now we live in New Jersey, and this lady says, 5 days ago, I was praying for you guys, and the Lord told me to send you this gift. You know, and so I just hope you're well. We haven't seen you in a while, but we're trusting that God's doing a great work in your guys' life and through your life, and so we love you. God bless you. And there was a scripture verse on there. And it was like, for the amount of money, for the bill, plus grocery money and treats. You know what I mean? And when that happens, you're like, God, you are so ahead of this thing. You know, like God is ahead of it. But the only time you learn that is when you need to know that God is ahead of it. And it's the downside of the wonderfully affluent culture we live in. And even the most impoverished among us is doing well. I mean, poverty in America still involves heat and blankets and a cell phone, you know, and all these things. And I'm not knocking. I know there's significant issues, but we're so blessed. And I think for some of you right now, you're here listening to this because God wants to remind you that he is faithful. And that he will provide. But we only learn it when we need his provision. If you can provide for yourself, you just provide for yourself. And for the children of Israel, they experienced in very powerful ways God's provision. And he said to them, look, everything you needed, you had. Nothing went wrong. Also, you have God's provision in regards to these kings, Sihon, the king of Heshbon, and Og, the king of Bashan, who we read about in the book of Numbers and also in Deuteronomy 2 and 3. You know, and the idea here is they conquered this land. And remember, they're on the east side of the Jordan. So remember, the tribe of Reuben, the tribe of Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, they are settling on this east side of the Jordan. The promised land is technically on the west side of the Jordan, but they wanted to be on the east side. And so God said, yes, you can stay, but when they go over to take that other land, you have to go with them. But this land can be yours. And so they're standing literally on this land that has already been given to them. And then we're reminded in verse 9, of course, that they need to keep the words of this covenant and they need to do them that they may prosper. And this is so important. It's not just about knowing the word. It's also about living the word out. That's why in the New Testament, God inspired the book of James, to remind us that true faith has feet on it. It's lived out. It's not enough just to know the word. Faith without works is what? It's dead. That's why we know it that way. See, your faith is not, we don't get saved by the works. We always have to make sure. The Apostle Paul wrote lots of letters to make sure we realize your works don't save you, but we have a faith that works. We don't do things so that God is happy with us. God is happy with us, and we respond to God's joy and relationship by living a certain way. And our faith is not devoid from the way that we live. Our faith actually is the motor or the engine that drives how we live. And because of your faith in Jesus, your life is supposed to be different. You have a different set of values. You have a different set of things that you care about. The economics of your heart and your relationships function differently. Why? Because the foundation of who you are is grace and mercy, even though you didn't deserve it. And so you move into every situation and you say, I did not deserve the grace that I am experiencing. And because I don't deserve it, I'm going to treat people in ways that they don't deserve. And it's a totally different way to live. So we have to make sure that we are not making the mistake of being people who hear the word and don't do it. That we're not making the mistake of being people who know what it says, but we are like, do as I say, not as I do. Because God wants our faith to be lived out in real time, that God may be glorified and the world may be blessed. Now in verse 10 it says, all of you stand today before the Lord your God, your leaders and your tribes and your elders and your officers, all the men of Israel, your little ones and your wives, also the stranger who is in your camp, from the one who cuts your wood to the one who draws your water, that you may enter into covenant with the Lord your God and into his oath, which the Lord your God makes with you today. Verse 13, that he may establish you today as a people for himself, and that he has spoken to you, and just as he has sworn to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, I make a covenant and this oath, not with you alone, but with him who stands here with us today before the Lord our God, as well as with him who is not here with us today. For you know that we dwelt in the land of Egypt, and that we came through the nations which you passed by, and you saw their abominations and their idols, which were among them wood, stone, and silver, and gold, so that there may not be among you man or woman or family or tribe whose heart turns away today from the Lord your God to go and serve the gods of these nations, and that there may not be among you a root bearing bitterness or wormwood. And so it may not happen that he hears the words of this curse, that he blesses himself in his heart, saying, I shall have peace, even though I follow the dictates of my heart as though I was a drunkard, could be included with the sober. The Lord would not spare him, for then the anger of the Lord and his jealousy would burn against that man, and every curse that is written in the book would settle on him, and the Lord would blot out his name from under heaven. And the Lord would separate him from all the tribes of Israel for adversity concerning all the curses of the covenant that are written in this book of the law. So really what we find here is that first God reminds them that they're all involved in this covenant. Notice who it's being addressed to. He's saying your leaders, your tribes, verse 10, your elders, your officers, all the men of Israel, your little ones and your wives, also the stranger who is in your camp. So he's saying this covenant is being made with everybody who is there, no matter where their office or space in life is, right? So this is a covenant that God is making with this whole community, and this whole community is full of all these different individuals. Notice it says in verse 12, that you may enter into covenant with the Lord your God and into his oath which the Lord your God makes with you today, that he may establish you today as a people for himself, and that he may be a God to you, just as he has spoken to you and just as he has sworn to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. What does God really care about? Notice, God wants a people for himself that he may be their God. That's what God cares about. It sounds so simplistic, but it's not simplistic, but it is simplistic. It's like when a man gets married to a woman. He stands before God and before his friends and says, I want you to be my people. And I want to be your people. We're going to be in this thing together. Right? And in the same way, all God wants is he wants relationship. He wants a people who are his own. And he wants to be able to be their God. And this covenant of being God to his own special people is a covenant that God had already made with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. He said, look, this is my plan. I am going to be a God to you, and you guys will be my people, and we will walk in relationship. That is why Jesus died and rose again, my friends. Because God wants to have a relationship with you. I said it this past weekend. God is the most relational person you will ever meet. God is the most extroverted, gregarious people person you've ever met in your entire life. No matter what time or mood you're in, if you talk to God, he'll talk. He's not like, listen, I didn't get my morning coffee. I had a rough night because all your brothers and sisters kept me up all night complaining about this and asking for a car and all that. It's like he's not like that. He loves it when we say, Abba, Father, help. And this is what God is interested in. God is interested in a group of people who are his own, that he can be their God. He just wants relationship. It's so beautiful. Now, you have to always remember, God's desire for relationship is not based in deficiency. This is important, because when you start talking about the fact that God desires relationship, a lot of us know what it's like, where we feel deficient, so we only feel whole when we're in relationship. God's relational nature is not like human feelings of deficiency. God's relational nature is fueled by his all-sufficiency. He doesn't need us, but we need him. And don't ever think that, like, you know, when it talks about God's jealousy, I'll never forget, I heard an interview with Oprah Winfrey, and she was talking about her upbringing and why she's no longer a follower of the Bible. And she said, well, I really don't like these passages about God being jealous. I just thought to myself, well, if he was really God, he wouldn't be jealous. You know, and that's in this passage, isn't it? Where it talks about God's bringing these curses and his jealousy on the people. And I started thinking about that, and I'm like, oh, okay, that's an interesting thing. And I started thinking to myself, I'm like, well, what did Oprah get wrong? And I'm like, oh, when she thinks of jealousy, she thinks of the self-centered, jealous boyfriend. If you have a boyfriend or a significant other who's always jealous all the time, really what it is they don't trust you, and really it just shows their own insecurities. See, but God's jealousy is not rooted in insecurity or deficiency. God's jealousy is rooted in his intense love and desire to bless. See, God is jealous that you can experience all that God has for you in life, because God loves you that much, and he doesn't need you to experience it, but God is jealous for you so much so that when you are not experiencing it, it breaks his heart. But not because he needs you to need him, but because you need him to be whole. So God's jealousy is not rooted in deficiency or insecurity. His jealousy is rooted in self-sacrificial love and all sufficiency. And that's why God cares. So don't think, because sometimes you're like, man, well, God's real needy. You know what I mean? Like, you know, God's going to be real upset with me because I don't talk to him all day long. And he's not insecure about who he is. His relational nature is built on the overflow of who he is, on his all-sufficiency. Now, what's interesting, as you move on from this, he reminds them, not only is he making the covenant with them, but all the people who are going to be coming after them. So this, the idea of this is not only for you standing here today, but everyone who's going to come, everyone who's going to be coming forward. And he reminds them, there were people who were before you, now there's going to be people coming after you. But right away, he moves into a warning about those who would make people stumble. Because listen, if the root of the covenant is God wants a people and he wants to be their God, then idolatry becomes a huge problem, doesn't it? Because they walk through all these nations, there are all these different gods and ways to worship and all these different ideas. And so right away he jumps on in, because he says in verse 17, and you saw their abominations and their idols, which were among them, wood and stone and silver and gold, so that there may not be among you man or woman or family or tribe whose heart turns away today from the Lord your God to go and serve the gods of these nations, and that there may not be among you a root bearing bitterness or wormwood. See, so now, because this covenant is about God having a people, he's saying, but what I am concerned about is that there's going to be people, whether it's an individual or a family or an entire tribe, who is going to start worshiping other gods and draw people away. So God is concerned with the, for lack of a simpler word, the fidelity of the covenant, the faithfulness of the covenant. And to use the marriage analogy, which obviously runs all through the scriptures, God is concerned that after this marriage is made, people's eyes and hearts are going to stray towards people other than their spouse. And no doubt, you read the Bible, what happens? The children of Israel are seduced by the gods of other nations. Even though God said, look, I want to be your God, and I want you to be my people, and I'm going to bless you, I've blessed you in the past, the people's hearts are bent on idolatry. They're bent on rebellion. You know, and when you read this kind of stuff, you always got to ask yourself this question: am I a person who is leading people astray? The way that I live, the things that I do, the way that I talk, is my testimony one of drawing people closer, or is my testimony one of pushing people away? Because Jesus did say that for the person who causes one of these little ones to stumble, it'd be better if he had a millstone hung around his neck and he was thrown in the ocean. Now, the millstone isn't like a little diamond pendant. It was like, you know, a big old boulder. It was meant to drown somebody. So somebody having a millstone, it's like you got a 100-pound boulder that he ties around your neck so that you sink to the bottom of the Sea of Galilee. This is about you being killed. That's the idea. And you gotta ask yourself, because each one of us has influence on people. And is your testimony of drawing people closer, or is your testimony about drawing people away? Now, I think what's interesting is some of the ways this is characterized. First, it's about serving the other gods of the nations. So to quote one of my favorite American theologians, Bob Dylan, everybody serves somebody, right? And so everybody serves someone, right? And so which god are you serving, right? Everybody serves someone. Next, when somebody chooses to serve another god, at the end of verse 18, it's called that there may not be among you a root bearing bitterness or wormwood. So the idea is that a root bearing bitterness or wormwood, that there is bitterness in the root that chokes out all the fruitfulness. So a person in the midst of a group of people who is serving other gods ends up poisoning the entire plant, that it moves through. And again, it's a good reminder. I think it's Jim Rohn who said it, is that, you know, if you show me your friends, I'll show you your future. That each one of us becomes the sum total of our five closest friends. We average in who our friends are, you know? And the idea is this, is that whatever is the influences in your life, that is going to impact who you are, right? And for the idea of apostasy, obviously it's seen as a root of bitterness. Not only that, as he continues to go on down, notice the way of the person who is bent on rebellion. Notice it says this, I shall have peace even though I follow the dictates of my own heart. My friends, I'll put it to you this way. I love saying this. I never get tired of saying this. Do not follow your heart. Follow Jesus and lead your heart. Our quote says, follow your heart. Wrong. Your Bible teaches that your heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? You know who can know it? The Lord of hosts knows it. That's how that verse goes. See, do not follow your heart. Your heart is your own personal Judas. And you don't even need me to explain that to you, because you look at the times when you followed your heart instead of following Jesus, and where did it land? The times that you just say, my heart told me to do this, and it didn't matter what Jesus thought, I just did it. You tell me how it went, because all I ever hear is that when I make decisions, I followed my heart and I neglected Jesus, it ends up in a place you don't want to be. So stop following your heart. Don't follow your heart. You follow Jesus and you lead your heart. Because what Jesus wants to do is he wants to focus the vision of our hearts on him. We don't follow our hearts. We follow the Lord. Your heart is designed to follow Jesus. And I think for some of you here right now, you are following your heart and you know that what I'm saying is true and you know you're playing with fire. And if that's you, you just got to turn. That word repent, you change your mind, which leads to a change of action. Don't follow your heart. Your heart will screw it all up. Isn't it true? It messes it up. It's designed, it's messed up by design. But following Jesus is important. See, what this guy does is he thinks, look, he's like, I'm going to have peace. I'm going to do whatever I want to do. I'm like the drunk guy thinking I'm just like the sober guy. And the answer is no. You're drunk. That's the problem. It's all messed up here. Now, look, what's unfortunate about all of this is we see what God's feelings are towards this. Notice what it says in verse 20. The Lord would not spare him, for then his anger, then the anger of the Lord and his jealousy would burn against that man, and every curse that is written in this book would settle on him, and the Lord would blot out his name from under heaven, and the Lord would separate him from the tribes of Israel for adversity according to all the curses of the covenant that are written in the book of this law. We just did this whole 3 or 4 part message on blessings and curses. We saw a few blessings, lots of curses, and I made the point, if you're going to choose one of these, which one you want? Everyone wants the blessings, so you got to make decisions so you experience the blessings. But this guy who doesn't want to follow the Lord, he's going to get the curses, and it's going to go bad, bad, B-A-D, nasty. It's not good. So don't be that guy. Look at your neighbor and say, don't be that guy. Unless it's a female, say, don't be that gal. Go ahead, do it too. Tell the other person. Don't be the knucklehead. That's what this is teaching. Okay. Verse 22, so that the coming generation of your children who rise up after you and the foreigner who comes from a far land would say when they see the plagues of that land and the sickness which the Lord has laid on it, the whole land is brimstone, salt, and burning. It is not sown, nor does it bear, nor does any grass grow there, like the overthrow of Sodom and Gomorrah, Admah and Zeboim, which the Lord overthrew in his anger and his wrath. All nations would say, why has the Lord done this to this land? What does the heat of this great anger mean? Then the people would say, verse 25, because they have forsaken the covenant of the Lord God of their fathers, which he made with them when he brought them out of the land of Egypt. For they went and served other gods and worshiped them, gods that they did not know and that he did not give to them. Then the anger of the Lord was aroused against that land to bring on it every curse that is written in this book. And the Lord uprooted them from their land in anger, in wrath, and in great indignation, and cast them into another land as it is to this day. Now you see what goes on here. What is God also concerned about? He's also concerned about the witness and testimony of the people who abandoned the covenant. He's saying, look, if you guys go the way of rebellion, all these other nations are going to say, what happened to these people? And like we're seeing it as we're studying the book of Daniel on Sundays, right? It's like they're in Babylon. Why? Because they abandoned the covenant. And Nebuchadnezzar would be like, well, who's the God that's going to deliver you? Because your God didn't deliver you from my hand, so you're stuck. See, you all, just like the children of Israel, you live out loud. You live out loud. And people know, and the surrounding nations knew about what God had done in Egypt. There was a testimony. Remember when they were traveling through the wilderness, all the nations were freaked out because they heard the stories of these the children of Israel and the plagues of Egypt and what God did. And they're like, we don't want to have anything to do with that. We're just going to stay out of the way. Hopefully we're going to make it through this thing. But really what we see here is he says, look, the judgment's going to come. It's going to be like the judgment of Sodom and Gomorrah. You can read about that in Genesis 19. He also adds Adma and Zeboim, which were confederate nations. If you remember that battle where Lot was taken captive and Abraham went out to go get Lot, these other nations were all neighbor nations to Sodom and Gomorrah. And they're like, look, the judgment that came on Sodom and Gomorrah is going to come on the children of Israel. And guess what? The people understand what happened. Because they followed other gods, they didn't follow their God. God uprooted them in anger, in wrath, and he sent them out of the land. This is what happens when the covenant is abandoned. Now, I'm going to invite the worship team to come out. I wanted to be able to close on verse 29 because it is the last verse of the chapter, of course. But this verse is so powerful, and it kind of comes out of nowhere, right? You hear this. Notice what it says. The secret things belong to the Lord our God. But those things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. What a powerful end to this. Because notice, really what we're reminded is that there are hidden things about what is coming that God already knows. Right? God knows what they are. But those things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever. You see that? So what it's saying is that it reminds, of course, of Isaiah 55, right? Verses 8 and 9, where it says that my ways are higher than your ways, says the Lord, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. Just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. See, listen, there are things that God knows that he hasn't told us. And those hidden things belong to the Lord. And we trust in the goodness of God, and we trust the fact that God, in his infinite wisdom, keeps certain things to himself for whatever reason, and he's trustworthy with what he knows. But there are things that he has revealed to us, and those are ours to cherish. And what has God revealed to us, my friends? This book. From Genesis to Revelation, the testimony of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Moses, and Joshua, and all the judges, and Samuel, and Saul, and David, and Solomon, and all the kings, and all the prophets, all the way on into the story of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and his apostles, and the apostle Paul, and all these things. These are for us, and for our children. And my friends, we live in a day and age where you can have a Bible in whatever translation, but there is a famine of Bible living in our land. You can get it read to you if you like an English accent. You get Max McLean. If you like James Earl Jones, you can get his voice. If you like a girl from Australia, you get an Australian accent. You can get whatever thing you want. We have a million translations and paraphrases, and I got my teen study Bible, and I got my Overcomers Bible, and all these things are great. But listen, in the end of the day, what God is really concerned about is that we may do all the words of this law. So however you get the word of God in, my friends, let's do that stuff empowered by the Holy Spirit. Do not let one more day go by that you do not put into practice what you already know. Our pastors talk about this a lot here at Crossroads amongst ourselves, about how we want to be quick to move good information into real-time action. If we realize there's something that's broken down that we're doing at Crossroads, right as we realize, we want to be quick to move from whatever it is into action if we have the right thing to do. We don't want to wait. We don't want to collect $200 when we pass go. We want to just get that thing moving. And that is a reality of life. I think for some of you right now, there are things that you know that you're supposed to be doing that you're not doing. You need to start doing it right now. And I get that in taking those steps of faith, oftentimes we're stepping over fears, or we're stepping over situations, and we're like, I don't know how that's going to work. But what I will tell you is all God wants you to do is take the step, and God will reveal how it all works as you are on the step. I always think of Teresa of Calcutta. When you look at the needs of the world, she said, oh, you want to feed 100 people who are hungry? Start with just one. Just start right where you start, small, dude. Just take the step. A journey is many steps, but it never begins until you take the first step. And I think for so many of us right now, there's things that God has placed before you that you're like, well, I don't understand how it's going to work. And what am I supposed to do? And, you know, just take the first step. Because while you are on the way, God will lead you. While you're on the way. Because what God really cares about is that we do this stuff. See, God knows that we live in a day and age, we love information. But God cares about life. Like who you are, where you are, who you're around, and how you are around them. God wants us to live this reality. That is why he's given us his spirit. He doesn't want us to fill our heads with information. He wants us to have real wisdom, the right application of the right information. And the only way to live a life of wisdom is to put into practice what you already know. So just ask yourself, what is something that you know right now you're supposed to be doing that you're not doing? And just say, tomorrow I'm going to start doing it. And tell somebody, tell one of your brothers and sisters and say, look, I realize that I need to begin this thing right now. Can you ask me how I'm doing on tomorrow? Because what happens when you take that step, all of a sudden you sense God's pleasure at you trusting him to be different than you would be normally. And then all of a sudden you get this great joy in your heart and you tell your friend and their faith gets strengthened. Like, wow, they took a step of faith. Wow, yeah, that's so cool. Well, guess what I'm going to do? And then before you know it, you're encouraging one another unto life and godliness. You're provoking one another unto love and good works. And now all of a sudden, when the people of God all begin to take these steps of faith, simply responding to Jesus, and they're encouraging one another, then all of a sudden you got yourself a little groundswell of revival going on. Because God's people are now stepping in and responding to the Lord, and we're getting encouraged by what God is doing. And I can't believe, you know, you'll never believe what door just opened and what just happened and what's going on. It's like, well, we're just walking out the reality that it tells us in the book. But we have such joy in the midst of taking the steps. So with what God has revealed to you, say, Lord, will you help me just to do it? Just to take the step. And I know that in steps of faith, the problem is, I always say, the problem with living by faith is what? You gotta live by faith. We love living by sight. We're used to living by sight. That's all we know. I know how this is going to work, so I know it's going to work, so I do it this way. But when you take a step of faith, all of a sudden God does something amazing, and you don't know how it's going to happen or what it's going to be. I know for me, I was talking to a good buddy of mine, a guy I played in a band with just recently, and I remember when God called me into the ministry. And I remember I'm leaving this band that we've recorded all these albums and we're getting touring gigs and it was so cool and it was my dream. And he said to me, he's like, man, I remember the day you told us you were going to leave the band and you're going to go into the ministry. I mean, he's like, who would have known? Now you're like on TV. He's like, how, like, why do they let you on TV? I'm like, beats me, bro, you know? But he's like, man, how crazy is that? And it's like, yeah, it's crazy. But it just began with, for me, just God saying, I want you to do this thing. And I'm like, okay. Like, you know, I'll go do this thing. Came to my pastor and said, I just feel God, I'm called to ministry. Can I do anything? He's like, yeah, what do you want to do? I'm like, anything. He's like, well, we need to dust those plants in the sanctuary. Fake plants. I shine those things for the glory of Jesus. Those things are probably still shining. 20 years later, those things are sparkly, man. No color on them. I stripped them, you know? But it all begins with just a step. I'll close here. We say it here all the time. It's all about simply responding to Jesus. It's that simple. Jesus invites us. We say, okay. And I think for each one of us, no matter how long you've been walking with the Lord or whether you're going to give your life to Jesus right here in the next 5 minutes, Jesus is inviting each one of us to take a step of faith. So just respond to him and trust him. Trust the revelation he's given us in his word and the godly guidepost he's put around your life. Just take a step and see what he's going to do. Let's bow our heads and our hearts as we pray. Father, we are renewing our commitment to you tonight. Lord, we never have to ask if you're going to renew your commitment, because with the eyes of faith, we look at the cross and we see Jesus not only crucified but resurrected, and we know that you have kept your end of the bargain. Lord, we experience not only the amazing power of your spirit, but that subtle conviction that reminds us that we're your kids, and we know that you've taken care of it. But Father, for the knobs on our side of the wall, we desire not just to